Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN music director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
This is David Dubal, and I am so pleased to have as my guest today the great Hungarian-born pianist, George Sándor. George, you have many things to say, and you told me to stop you if you go on too much, because you do not really, in my opinion, have a tendency to do that. You have what I call a vast storehouse of not only knowledge and experience. I said, where do you live? Well, you said, I live at Kennedy Airport. You are constantly touring the world playing the piano. And you're not only going to discuss your career, but the fact that you have now on the market Shermer's books, just published your On Piano Playing. How do you feel about now being an author?
Well, I'm very impressed, Dave, because this book was released last year after hibernating about 5 years, so when I read it, it seemed to be quite new and interesting. Oh. I hope it's interesting for other people, too.
Well, it's more than interesting. I think that this is one of the very important books to come out on the technique of piano in a long time. It takes a certain kind of mind to sit down and write on technique, because you really cannot say anything in a way that is not precise, and this book is precise. It's subtitled Motion, Sound, and Expression, and there are photographs of your hands throughout the book, and many, the topics are unbelievable. I said before, well, I should start practicing 8 hours a day again. He said, read page 17. No need to practice 8 hours a day.
Well, actually, if I may qualify what you said, this really is not only the technique of piano playing. This is an effort to tie in interpretation and motions, mm-hmm. which we commonly call technique. When mm-hmm. you move at the piano, we call it technique, because I don't mean that you move your fingers, because the basic idea of the book is that we are a totally integrated mechanism, the human body, and when we play the piano or bicycle or play golf or play the cello, we use the whole body. Mm-hmm. And I think the main problem with pianists is that they are training their fingers.
Aha.
So they should train other particles of the human body too, their minds too. But of course, piano playing is not at all a matter of finger velocity or strength. And I believe, unfortunately, we have enough proofs of that, that a lot of wonderful pianists who trained all their life to develop strength in their fingers had to give up playing the piano, mm-hmm. because you just simply don't develop finger strength. Mm-hmm. You utilize the stronger muscles. So the technical part of the book consists of that, how to activate the respective groups of muscles so that we never ever strain, never feel uncomfortable, or never tired piano playing. But I think the more important part is that this kinetic, these physical activities, these motions have to be synchronized or equated with mm-hmm. the musical content. Mm-hmm. In other words, interpretation and technique are one, mm-hmm. and I think the technical formula we utilize have to be derived from the emotional context of the music.
Mm-hmm. Well, you see, that has always been a problem with, I think, Western man. He has said the art and the technique are two different things. Later on, after I know how to do it, I'll become an artist, right. or I'll put the color in.
Yes.
And it's interesting that the Greek word for art and skill is the same word. They don't technique, something like that. I'm not sure of the pronunciation. Technique is derived from it, but we now think of technique as just a skill. To the ancient Greeks, technique was skill and art. It was one word.
Right.
The combination,
right.
the ideal merging.
Well, that's very interesting, because actually I do use this definition that piano technique is a skill, but art or interpretation of music, that's something else that includes part of that concept which you call skill, which is really the ability to move muscles,
yes.
or to move fingers.
George Sándor is my guest, and he has written On Piano Playing, which is a book I'm going to push because I really think it's fascinating. George, do you mind if I read a couple of the chapter headings? Because
yes.
I know there are a lot of pianists that listen to this program, and your career as a teacher, of course, has also been invaluable. There's after your preface, there's chapter one, music, motions and emotions. Then there is a whole chapter on the piano. Then the human performing mechanism. Then a chapter called Free Fall, and that's based on the weight and the muscles and the lifting, the hands, the dropping, guidelines, exercises. It's phenomenal. Then there's the five fingers, chapter five, and scales and arpeggios. Then there's rotation. What is rotation?
Well, actually, since you read these paragraphs, if I may just suggest this, after describing the piano as a mechanism and the human mechanism, I'm trying to reduce all the existing motions that we executed the piano to five different groups.
Uh-huh.
And those actually do cover the entire gamut, the entire range of piano playing. One is free fall, the other one is finger or scales or arpeggio technique.
Uh-huh.
Rotation is a forearm rotation, forearm motion, with which you handle all the tremolos, trills, and same things like that. Then comes the staccato type motion, which covers all the octave playing, or six, or double third playing. And then what I call thrust is the technique of playing chords, where you actively utilize the entire human mechanism without weight.
Mm-hmm.
And I also try to clarify in this book, there's a slight confusion which exists when people talk about weight technique,
mm-hmm.
because obviously weight figures and does have something to have to do with piano playing. But weight itself is a dead something. You only use weight when it's in motion.
Mm-hmm.
And once it's in motion, you might as well use as little weight as possible.
I understand.
Because the acceleration, the force of gravity causes acceleration for small amount or large amount of weight, the same ratio. So you don't mobilize the entire weight. You use as little weight as possible.
How interesting.
In order to achieve the same results.
George, now we're going to open the musical section of our program with the Prokofiev Toccata, which certainly is a work that demands motoric energy, rhythm, and so forth. How do you approach practicing the Prokofiev Toccata?
Motion number three. Staccato motion.
Page what?
Page, I don't know. That's that the Prokofiev Toccata actually is being done with the number three motion, which is number four, staccato.
Uh-huh.
It's not always staccato sound, but the technique is that of the staccato. It's the throne, you throw the fingers, whether it's in single notes or double notes, fast or slow, you use the whole arm,
uh-huh.
and you absolutely can be tireless, you don't tire, and you achieve.
And you don't tire playing the Prokofiev Toccata.
My dear Dave, you never ever tire playing anything.
I have to read your book closer because my arms fell off, and of course the my whole third finger was paralyzed for a month after practicing.
Never too late.
Okay, now we're going to hear your performance of the Opus 11 of Prokofiev, his Toccata, which was just a revelation when it was composed around 1910 or 11. We now hear my guest, Hungarian-born virtuoso György Sándor in Prokofiev's Toccata. Thank you. Prokofiev Toccata in the hands and brain of George Sándor, and he tells me that that's motion four, staccato. Well, it's fantastic, and now I understand why he can write a book on piano playing. Right after this message or two, we will be right back with more talk from my guest, George Sándor. George, the next music we'll be hearing is the Schumann Toccata, and we'll get to that later. I want to say that really I am impressed with this book. I just love books on piano playing, of course, and this one is just so, as memorization, singing tone, how to practice, all of this. Schirmer sent me a blurb on it. It says, I want to ask you if this is correct, because I'm always certain that most of these blurbs are never right. On piano playing is unique in that Sándor reduces technique to five fundamental motions and patterns, the combinations and variants of which form the entire scope of technique. Are they correct?
That's pretty correct, yes.
Good,
yes.
Good. Anyway, it's quite a book, $17.95, not bad for today's prices. It has photographs, it has, wow, it's wonderful, line drawings and so forth. And it's Schirmer's books, and I wish you the best of luck on that book. You're an author now, a pianist, you transcribe music, and so forth. It's $20. I'm sorry. Prices
That's
go up every minute, you know, every minute. Let's now talk about something different. You travel everywhere. You were just in Mexico. Your career has been truly worldwide. How is the world today? I mean, everyone is so pessimistic.
Well, the world is the same, except it's bigger and better than before.
Better, huh? That's interesting.
We like to say the world is coming to an end, and I think I mentioned it before, that since we know of human conscience of the world, there's always this promise that the world is coming to an end. Since 2,000-3,000 years, they always talk about the world coming to an end. We have now the means, really, to come to an end, but I think not to a real end. The scare of atomic bomb and all that is very justified, but I believe that the world won't come to an end at all. There might be some horrible damages here and there, but unfortunately, we know from the last big war, where there were about 15 or 20 million dead, which was really a fantastically impressive and horrible figure. If you realize the fact that there are 4 billion people still carrying on, it's not that much of an end of the world. And it
but
is
there was
indeed,
no weaponry then compared to now.
Not yet. Well, they used, of course, the atomic bomb.
Tell me, why do you say that it's bigger and better? Why are you not pessimistic, as so many people are?
I can oblige. I can be.
I mean, I want you to be right. I know you've never been wrong before.
God,
I mean, in this time span I've known you, which has been a long time, so I'm very glad you're saying this.
Well, the fact that it's bigger is undoubtedly so. There are more than 4 billion people living. Not the more people in the world. Better, in a way, it is too, because there are many, many more people today who live much, much better than ever before. Mm-hmm. There's still a lot of hunger and a lot of misery, too. That is true. But we have at least all the means and all the media to remedy this thing. Now, whether we will use them or not, that's not a question. But I'm just will be optimistic and realize that the distribution of goods today, when we have planes and we have all kind of media with which you can distribute things faster, will happen someday. Of course, bad things are being distributed faster too. Mm-hmm. But somehow I do like to feel that the instinct of survival is strong enough in the human race. Mm-hmm. And we have some guidance too. Mm-hmm. So I think things are not as bad as they look.
Good. Good. I'm glad to hear that.
And as far as pianos go, mm-hmm. there are many more pianos all over the world. As you mentioned before, I do tour all over the world. There are many more pianos, many more people who listen to music. There's greater interest.
You mean art music, as we understand it, has an impact in the world now?
Absolutely.
Still?
Well, in this country, you know, you have about 4,000 universities that pour out people who know about music.
And where are they going to go, though? I mean, is there...
Well, I hope they won't go anywhere. They sit down, play the piano, play the violin, and make music. Mm-hmm. They don't have to make music in public all the time. They make music at home.
But how do people survive who are trained as musicians who cannot teach in universities? There are no jobs. Or
well, Dave, the tradition in musical existence always was that people were starving, and that's a fairly new development. I think today many, many more musicians live much better than ever before. There are many more orchestras, many more teaching possibilities. There are radio stations, there are television mm-hmm. stations. The distribution of music to a much greater extent than ever before.
Sure.
And I think there's a chance that things will normalize themselves and people will make a fairly decent living, if not a very luxurious living. They never did before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As we well know before in music, people who really made a lot of money were the Liszts and Chopins, maybe.
Paganini
or Paderewski. But even they didn't make so much money.
There was always a big star system, no matter what,
yes,
right? And most,
yes,
the majority just got along. And you're saying that more get along better than ever before.
Ever before, of course. In this country, for instance, these 4,000 universities teach music.
Yeah.
Now, in Europe and the rest of the world, it says not spread as fast yet as here, but they are going in the direction too.
Yeah. The musical life, let's say, of New York or London is so fantastic compared to anything in the 19th century that if a music lover went to London in 1880, let's say, even, they would be flabbergasted.
Absolutely.
At the programs, maybe 12 orchestral concerts,
yes,
a year, that kind of thing.
One drawback might be that since there is so much music consumed, the general level of consumption is lowering, broadening, so to say. But in the long run, that's not bad either, because the so-called elite will always exist, and always existed before. And among those many people who use music or listen to music, which is maybe not the very highest level, there will be always a group that chooses the best, the Hammerklavier sonatas and the Opus 135 quartets and Blade Bartok and all that.
And after all, those late Beethoven string quartets were unknown for half a century after Beethoven's death. And today, Bartok, who died in 1945, your own piano teacher, he's a revelation to many people. Once such a small span of time from 45 to 1980, let's say 1982 where we are, he's considered a master. His music in his lifetime considered difficult, now accessible to a greater mass than it had ever possibly had the chance to call modern music, you know.
Yes, the concerto for orchestra, I think, is the most recorded orchestral work in the repertoire.
It's fantastic, isn't it?
So I think the prognosis can be quite good for music in general.
Mm-hmm. Now, you as a teacher, you've had a wide career that way. You were in Michigan for years, right?
Yes.
You have now come back to New York, where you belong, and you're teaching at the celebrated Juilliard School now.
Well,
how was that?
I was delighted. It was a surprise for me, too. I left Michigan after 20 years. I taught before at SMU in Dallas, too, for 5 years, Santa Barbara Music Academy of the West, too. And I did teaching sporadically all over the world with master classes.
Oh, you've
and all
loved
that.
You're a teacher, if I've ever seen one.
Well, I like to talk about music and like to demonstrate what I think is right. And if you call a teacher, that's what the teacher does usually. When I came back from a tour in Mexico last March, I was invited by Mr. Manning to join Juilliard. And since I do live in New York now, I was delighted with the idea. I won't be a full-time teacher there. I will have a certain limited number of students, and I will hope to be able to carry on like I did before with concertizing and teaching as much as possible.
Yeah. Now, are they buying your book, your students?
I hope so. I don't know. I hope so. It's all very new yet.
Yeah. We're going to hear you in another toccata. I don't want to make you into a toccata specialist here. The Schumann toccata, though, is certainly a specialty for anyone that has great double notes. How do you practice the Schumann toccata?
Well, that's not number four.
That's not the staccato.
Except for the octave passage. Uh-huh. There it's staccato. But that's simply an activity where the fingers are being helped or must be helped by the wrist.
Yeah.
Wrist goes down, up and down most of the time when they have this double note. And then again, I don't want to anticipate what's in the book, but whenever you use your thumb, Dave, I would suggest always put your wrist a little lower. And when you use other fingers, go a little higher. So that continuous change of position of the wrist guarantees not only that the fingers are at ease and comfortable, but helps to avoid any kind of stiffness and rigidity.
Mm-hmm. How interesting.
And you don't need strength.
Now, when's this recorded? Because this is a very fast performance, like Simon Barrère's.
Just about, yes. This I wouldn't dare to say it loud, but this was recorded during the 78th of recordings yet. When the maximum you could do was 4.5 minutes on one side.
Yeah.
And we did record that many, about 30, 35 years ago, and I did finish it in 4 minutes and 28 seconds.
Well, it's an exhilarating performance. We're
but
going
if
to,
I, if
there
I
are people that do it in 7 minutes.
Yes, but if I may tell you, I want to say that my next recording was in 7 minutes, because I repeated the exposition, so that we were not limited by time. But here, the speed was a factor.
Well, we're going to hear, this is one of the great double note tests in the literature, isn't it?
Right.
We're going to hear my guest, George Sándor, in Schumann's delectable toccata. The delectable land of double notes, as James Huneker once wrote. Mm-hmm. done in the days of 78 when you had to get it done by 4 minutes and 30 seconds, and Sándor did, and he said, I even got a chance to make a retard there. I myself love the Schumann Toccata, fast and furious, and what velocity and strength you have. And after this message or two or three, we'll be back with my guest, George Sándor. This is David Dubal, and my guest today, George Sándor, who is now in New York teaching at the Juilliard School and making his home at Kennedy Airport, where he is constantly circulating the globe, circling it, circumnavigating it, where you bring, well, you do things that are sensational, such as all three Bartok concertos in one evening. I think you were, am I mistaken, the man who gave the premiere of Bartok Third Concerto. Is that right, with Ormandy?
That is right, Dave, yes. Bartok passed away in 1946, September, and this concerto was found, which he wrote that for his wife, actually,
yes.
Bassett, although I have been with Bartok till really the very, very last moments of his life and the funeral, too. He never mentioned to me a word about this concerto.
No.
Now, Tibor Sherley, who finished the orchestration of the last 17 measures of the Bartok concerto, called me up on December 3rd, 1945, telling me about this concerto, would I want to present it? And we got in touch through Goddard Lieberson, who was a great admirer of Bartok. We got in touch with Mr. Ormandy, and the first performance was, I think, January 26, 1946.
And that really, in many ways, is the last contemporary concerto to have a worldwide audience.
Just about.
Yeah.
It was very popular, actually, right from the very first presentation.
You were the first to ever do the three in one concert, too, right?
Well, it turned out to be not the truth. I announced it like that in 1970, when Bartok had its 25th death anniversary. We announced at Carnegie Hall, I presented the three concertos with Gregory Millar, the three Bartok concertos, but it turned out that Mr. Sebuk, George Sebuk, apparently has done it before in Paris with Léon Barzin.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I was informed after the concert took place about this. But
there's always someone like that, you know, that informs
yes.
you
but
that
I have
you
done
didn't
it
do
many
it
times
first.
After that, too.
I know you
I
have.
Did many times.
With great success, too, George. What I want to ask you now is your how did you come to making the piano technique simplified in your mind and then to write the book? Because you studied with a man I am sure never taught you like that, and his name was Bartok himself. You studied piano with Bartok, not composition. He never taught composition.
That is correct. He never taught composition. I was very fortunate. I studied composition with Kodály and studied piano with Bartok. And as you said, he never, ever explained piano technique. He was one of the most colossal pianists, Bartok. Unfortunately, we have not enough proofs of that. There are very few recordings left.
But what we do have is amazing.
What we have is absolutely amazing. That's right. This is fantastic Kreutzer Sonata with Siget, amongst other things. But anyway, he never taught technique. Now, I must tell you, I studied with him between the age of 18 and 22. And I was, I think, one of the many very confused pianists. Because I did play the piano, I played things like Liszt Don Juan Fantasy and Brahms Concerto, all kind of big pianistic works, and I had absolutely no idea how I do those things. So after 4 years of real suffering and listening and observing a lot of other great pianists who in those days functioned like Hoffmann and Paderewski and Rachmaninoff and whomever you want, Korto, I came to the conclusion that they all look different, they all seem to play differently, and actually they all do the same thing.
Really?
Which is nothing else but taking the best possible advantage of the playing mechanism, play as effortlessly as possible, producing as beautiful sounds and as big and as small sounds as possible, and none of them made any particular effort. I mean physical effort, intellectual, spiritual, emotional
sure.
effort, yes. So what I tried to do, and I hope I managed, I started from two fundamental things. The characteristics of the piano as an instrument. It's a percussion instrument where the hammer strikes the strings, and the faster those strings strike the string, the louder you're playing will be, and vice versa, the slower, the softer will be. And the other one is the human mechanism. Now, the human mechanism is exactly the same in Iceland or in China or in Budapest or in New York.
Mm-hmm.
The human anatomy is the same. And if we do take proper advantage or utilize properly the functions of the large and small muscles and are able to coordinate them, we certainly will not go through the suffering of tensing up, of straining ourselves, we can play without any effort. I don't see that we play relaxed, because nobody can play relaxed. You can sleep when you are relaxed, but you can't move a finger when you are relaxed. But you certainly can mobilize those fingers in the most economic way and always draw from other sources, from the strong muscles, instead of trying to strengthen and fortify the weak muscles. And I think most of the pianistic problems come from that, and the rather unpleasant sound on the piano comes from that fact that weak muscles are being strengthened, strained, and produce a very unpleasant sound and get tired. Mm-hmm. And if you keep on insisting, working mechanically especially, and building up muscles, you will get tendonitis, you will get all kind of inflammations. And if you keep on insisting and you still keep on playing when you have tendonitis, then you will have to stop playing piano altogether.
Many people get it, don't they?
Unfortunately, it's quite impressive. There are some world-famous pianists who actually stop playing. Let's not talk about Schumann. You talked mm-hmm. about the Schumann toccata before. He ruined his hands with the Schumann toccata. Mm-hmm. But even today, there are a lot of pianists who simply stop playing the piano. And I know innumerable pianists, not only I, you know them very well too, who suffer.
Mm-hmm. I sure do.
Their braces, their arm is aches and hurts, and then they try to cure those ailments not by eliminating the motions which cause ailments, but by trying to strengthen muscles so they feel numb. They don't feel the pain anymore. And that, of course, is even worse.
So at 22, after 4 years of study with Bartok and hearing all of these great pianists and coming to this conclusion, what did you start doing? Experimenting, taking notes, what?
Yes,
of course, eventually, we get many years later this book on piano playing that we're discussing today.
Well, this is really the result of classifying or organizing emotions.
You really did. You classified it as a scientist.
Yes, you said. Well, it's a very primitive and ordinary activity, I must say, because all we have two sources of energy. Our own muscles is one, and that is the force of gravity. That's all we have. So everything that happens at the piano is the result of these two sources of activities or their combination. So there's a so-called free fall when you raise your arm and your hand and then let it drop. The force of gravity will accelerate the speed at which it will fall, will produce a sound. Now, of course, it's very important to know in what position your hand should be, and so on and so forth. So there are five distinct motions. What I try to do in this book, classify all motions according to these concepts, describe exactly under what circumstances those motions can be executed in the most economic way, always taking in consideration that every human body is different, mm-hmm. although fundamentally we are the same, but the length of the forearm, the weight of the fingers, the width of the fingers, all they are individual things. So what I tried was to try to coordinate these motions in the most effective, the most economical way to produce those motions which produce the sounds.
When you get up and you start your practicing day, how do you do it? Describe what you go through. Let's say it's a new work.
Dave, I'm sorry to tell you, I don't ever suggest to anybody to practice technique. And I don't practice technique. You have to have technique. You acquire. When you acquire these motions, these fundamental motions, it's just like learning how to bicycle or learn how to write. Once you learn the alphabet, once you have learned the alphabet, you don't practice the alphabet. You write.
What about, let's say we had five pianists here, Rachmaninoff and Hoffman and Arthur Rubinstein or Franz Liszt. These people didn't systemize it necessarily. They would, you said they all played with the same idea, and yet intellectually they wouldn't be able to describe it, right?
No, I could never see that they knew or that they on purpose willfully did certain things. No.
With some people it was instinct.
Well, we are all born with a so-called talent, with coordination, with a natural coordination. When children go to the piano, they play very naturally, very freely.
Yeah.
Then they get through the discipline of strengthening the fourth finger.
Yeah.
And then they push their elbow down and they paralyze those muscles which really move the fingers, and they begin to suffer. So I don't say that you have to know this book, God forbid this.
Uh-huh.
On the contrary, actually when you perform in public, you never think ever of these things. You do this only as a preliminary work.
Yeah.
When you want to be conscious of what you are doing, then you can simplify those motions to their basic characteristics, employ them, and then make music.
As a teacher, do you have resistance from your students, pupils, when they themselves say, no, I can't do it like this? Because they've come to you from many years of different training?
Well, I think anybody who wants to study is because he or she has problems. Because if you know something, then you don't go and study.
How interesting.
You know. I mean, why would you go and learn, try to learn how to play octaves if you know how to play octaves?
Uh-huh.
Now, musically, interpretatively, that's another question. You can have musical ideas. But I believe that the interpretative and technical aspects are so closely knit, so together, that you can't separate the two.
Yeah.
Now, I wouldn't say that I don't think I find conscious resistance. There is resistance by inertia or by habits. People are used to practice a certain way. And please don't think for a moment, Dave, that I say that unless you play the piano exactly the way I say, you will be a bad pianist. Mm-hmm. There are some wonderful pianists who practice very differently. They have their own rituals, they have their own formulae which they go through, and somehow they play wonderfully well. But what I'm against is the following. Don't practice differently than you play. Don't practice a certain. Don't practice slowly with raised fingers when you do something else when you play faster.
How interesting.
So you should practice the way you will resolve those problems.
Now, for 4 years, you studied piano with the Royal Academy with Bartok, right, in Budapest.
Right.
What did he teach you, by the way?
Music.
Talk to me about this.
Well, first of all, if
I studied with one of the great composers that ever lived.
I was very fortunate. I must say, for 1 year, I studied with him privately. I went to his home. Studied with him, had lessons every week.
Did he like you as a person, as a pianist?
I hope he did. I was too awed and too, bewildered.
What kind of personality did he have?
He was a wonderful person, very reserved, very sensitive, very well-mannered. He was not just a great musician, he was a great human being. I mean, as far as literature or any other knowledge of human art or other products, he knew a great deal about everything.
Mm.
He was not a politician, but he had his very clear ideas to what is right and what is wrong. But he was a fantastic musician, and all I had to do and all he did, he sat down and played, and I observed what he did. And one thing which is very important, David, I think I would like to mention that his playing under any circumstance, and no matter what he played, was always very free.
Very free.
What we call rubato playing.
Yes.
It was a live playing. And I remember the first impression I had when I heard him from close, he'd sit down and play the scale was uneven. I always was trained and I thought, please, scale have to be even. Not at all. A scale played by Bartok, when it went through the dominant or the subdominant or the leading note, had a little extension, a little different coloring.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the music was alive. It always came from somewhere and went somewhere. It was never mechanically apportioned.
I've heard him on record doing a Brahms Capriccio in B minor. I cannot believe it. There's no modern pianist who would dare play that
That's
freely.
Unfortunately.
And yet Bartok interpreters always play as if, you know, this is percussive music.
Terrible.
He himself played his own music very unpercussively.
Very freely. And you should have heard him play Scarlatti or Bach.
There are six Scarlatti sonatas, which are unreal.
I must say that even today, when there is a pianist, I don't want to mention names, if there's a pianist who plays that way, they have phenomenal success everywhere. People who play who really have worldwide success are the pianists who play freely.
Mm-hmm.
They don't exaggerate and don't distort. Of course, Bartok didn't either, but they play freely. I mean, music is the tempo indications are not mechanical indications; they are mood indications. And when you play those, except when you play Prokofiev Toccata, where you have to really play motorically, when you play a melody, you never should play those 8 notes evenly.
Now, after your years with Bartok as a piano student, did you know him professionally?
Very much so, yes. And I must say, after the age of 22, when I stopped studying with Bartok, I did not study with anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
I was in touch with Bartok, and of course I was with him a great deal when he came over to this country.
Yeah.
He spent his last 5 years of his life, he spent here in the United States.
Well, you've been a remarkable champion of him. You have lectured on him. You have done the whole set of Microcosmos and talked about him. You have played the concerto. You have the complete recordings of his piano music on Vox. You have done yeoman's work for your teacher.
Well, I was fortunate enough to have known him sooner, maybe, or better than other people did. I studied most of these works with Bartok, and he became very fashionable. Now, when I came over here to the States, I was not at all the Bartok pianist. I was the Liszt pianist.
Mm-hmm, that's right.
Because I was Hungarian, and we are always classified according to our birthplace.
Well, we're going to hear your Liszt later on in the program. Just before that, though, we're going to now go to your composition teacher, because you have made many wonderful transcriptions, arrangements. I don't know about original works because I haven't ever discussed it with you. But Kodály, whose 100th anniversary is in December, was your composition teacher, and we're going to hear you perform a meditation on a motif by Debussy, a rather impressionist early Kodály. Tell me just a moment of that experience with
Kodály. Well, I studied, I majored in composition with Kodály, so I went through the mill. I studied for 5 years, and we started study composition from motifs to masses or to symphonic works. So we went through the whole thing, and of course I had to write a lot of compositions as a student, but I'm not a composer. Mm-hmm. I just studied composition to become a better musician, and we did have this discipline of studying, for instance, vocal counterpoint, a two-part 16th century counterpoint for about 3 years.
Really?
And so on and so forth. So Kodály was a wonderful composition teacher. He had a very strange way, I must say. He never told you what to do. He always told you what not to do. Mm-hmm. So he never explained what the rondo form is, but he says, bring rondo forms for the next lesson. We've had to bring 4 or 5 compositions. And then he started to criticize. So we all knew what not to do music, but there are very few composers who studied with Kodály and carried on as composers.
He was a subtle man, wasn't he?
Very much so, yes. Very much to the point, too.
My guest is George Sándor today, and we're going to hear him play his composition teacher's meditation on the motif of Claude Debussy, the composer Kodály Zoltán. the impressionist style of Kodály in a work called Meditation on a Motif of Claude Debussy. And the artist, my guest today, George Sándor. And after these words, I will be right back with him. My guest today, George Sándor, and we have heard Prokofiev, Schumann, Kodály, his teacher. George, tell me what Kodály said to you. I just think it's so wonderful in one of your last encounters with him.
Oh, yes, he was here in the States in 1967, just a few months before he passed away. And we spent some time together at Interlaken, also in Michigan. And when he was in Washington, he heard through some friends that I have a birthday, September 21st of September. So he wrote me a very sweet note in Hungarian where he says, live slow. No, he says, many happy returns for your birthday. And he says, live slowly so it lasts longer.
Live slowly so it lasts longer. Sultan Kodály. He
was 84 at that time, so he knew it from experience.
He was quite a beautiful human being, wasn't he?
Oh, he was a wonderful person. I mean, not just a wonderful-looking person.
Yes.
Very Christ-like.
Yes, wonderful.
Very impressive. But a wonderful human being. And he had one of the most colossal memories you can think of. He remembered anything or everything he heard in music, the students wrote, everything. It was
extraordinary.
A wonderful human character.
Well, he is at 100th anniversary coming up, and we're going to end with another fellow Hungarian, another compatriot of yours, and his name, of course, the most famous Hungarian that ever lived. Perhaps so, huh? Franz Liszt. Now, would you have liked to have heard him play?
No doubt, yes.
Yeah, everyone says that.
There's no way to do that. But I must say that I was, in a way, fortunate because Bartók was a student of István Toman.
Who studied with Liszt.
Who studied with Liszt. And, of course, everybody is brought up in the Liszt tradition. Mm-hmm. The strange thing is, Dave, as you well know, when you talk to Rubinstein or to Horowitz, they all tell you the real great pianists were the great Rubinstein, Anton Rubinstein, or Busoni. When you talk to those people, they say the real great pianists were Liszt and Thalberg.
Yeah.
So apparently the piano playing of Liszt is not just legendary, but you can judge from his compositions how much he knew about piano.
He sure did.
He was certainly one of the most colossal.
Mephisto Waltz is great fun to practice and play, isn't it?
It sure is, yes.
Wow. Now, you have in your book on piano playing, there must be, because this is a 10-minute piece with a lot of different things, there must be all five of the of the motory syntaxes that you have developed in it, right? Everything
yes,
is in it.
A technique of scales, of free fall,
chromatic,
rotation,
octaves, glissandi,
and chords.
Chords.
And what else? And Mephisto.
And when you do it,
diabolic things.
When it's over with, you are not tired, right?
No, God forbid.
Well, you're not going to be tired now because we're going to do it from your recording.
Great.
All you have to do is listen with me. The great George Sándor in Liszt's great Mephisto Waltz.
Thank you.
We have just heard the diabolical George Sándor in a fantastic performance of Liszt's Mephisto Waltz. I want to thank you so much for coming here. George Sándor, one of the really great pianistic thinkers of our time. And I wish you, George, the best of luck on this wonderful new book on piano playing by yourself. I wish you luck with it.
Thanks, David. It's a pleasure not only to be with you, but I listen so much to NCN, WNCN. Nice to be here.
It's a great station, isn't it?
Be able to contribute a little bit.
We all
love
it. Thanks
so much for having me here.
And thanks for coming. And this is David Dubal, and thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.